Hello friends, this video on metal and non-metal part 15 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Before watching this video, please make sure that you have watched part 1 to part 14. Enrichment of ores. So what is this? See, generally the ore which we get, right, it has mud, it has a lot of stuffs in that. Mud, stones. So before we start the chemical reaction process on this, it is good to remove this mud, stone and all. And this can be removed without any chemical process, right? So you remove the mud, you remove the stone, and your ore is enriched. It has more ores actually. And this process is called enrichment of ores. Where if you see, the ores mined from the earth usually have impurities like soil, sand, and they are called gang. They're called gang. These are the impurities. Impurities in the ores are called gang. So what we do is, this has to be removed before we start the chemical process on this, right? So before we start the extraction of the metal process, we remove this, and these are removed based on the physical property. For example, sometimes you crush the ore and then use the sieve kind of thing, right? To filter, then you can remove that. Or sometimes you dissolve in water, the mud dissolves in water. So a lot of process we use which doesn't involve any chemical process. They are just physical process where we take the advantage of the physical property of the ore to remove the gangs or the impurities. So this process is called enrichment, where we remove the impurities from the ores, right? So in this, different separation techniques are applied accordingly based on the ores. So we'll not study this in deep now. Just understand that before you get the ore from the nature, it has mud, it has stone, it has sand in it, because nature composed of mud, sand, stone. So you have to remove all these things unnecessarily, because before you start the reaction of the ore is really the oxide form. Before you start the reduction process or any other process, you want to remove these things, and removal of this process is called enrichment of ores. Once your ore is enriched, you have ores without sand or mud, you start the extraction process of the metal. Right, so the process is like this. You get ore from earth, okay? Then you enrich it, remove, that is remove sand, stone, etc. Once it is enriched, you start the extraction process. For extraction process, it depends whether it is a metal of low activity series, metal of middle activity series, or metal of high activity. For all these three, we'll have different extraction processes. We'll explain that. So let's take this chart, which gives a clear picture of extraction. So you have this ore, which have the concern. We did this enrichment first. So enrichment is done here. Enrichment is done, and we have got this step now. In this, then we have three options: high reactive, medium reactive, low reactive. Right? In case it is low reactive, and you get sulfide ores. Generally, with low reactives, you get sulfide ores. Then you roast that metal, you get the metal, and then you refine it. I'll explain this part. So in case it is low reactive, you get sulfide ores, and then you do a roasting. I'll tell you what roasting is, and then you get the metals, and then you further refine it. In case of medium reactive substance, you either get carbonate ores or sulfide ores, right? So in that case, what you do calcination in case of carbonate ores to convert that carbonate ore into oxide ores. In case of sulfide ores, again you do a roasting to convert into oxide ores. So the end of the day, we want to convert everything into oxide ores, right? Oxide. So when it is oxide, we just reduce this metal. So once you have oxide, you can heat in the presence of carbon, or there are various processes of reduction. We'll explain that. And then once you have the metal, you can purify it. For high reactive thing, you have to get this electrolysis of the molten. You have to heat that ore, you have to keep it in the molten form, and then use the electrolysis to get the pure metal, because that's the only option. So three options: low reactive, medium reactive, you get carbonate or sulfide ores. Then you can use this carbonate ore, you can use the calcination, sulfide ore, you can use roasting, because the end goal is to first get the metal oxide, because metal oxide, when you have it, is the next step is simple, just reduce it and get the metal, correct? So let me repeat this. You have sulfide ores, you do the roasting, you get the metal, you refine it. For the low reactive, for medium reactive, you may get carbonate or sulfide ores. You have to convert this into oxide ores. If you have carbonate, you use calcination. If you have sulfide ores, you use roasting. You have this metal oxide, you reduce it, you purify it. That's all. And for high reactive, use electrolysis. So we'll discuss this one by one again. So let's start with the low reactive elements or metal. So if you see, these metals are very unreactive, and sometimes you get, if you have oxides of this metal, you can just heat that guy. Just by heating only, if you have metal oxide for the low reactive, you just heat it, you get metal. We'll explain that. For example, you have HgS called cinnabar, one of the ore of mercury. When you heat in the air, it becomes HgO. When you further heat it, it becomes mercury. The reaction is like this. You have HgS, the cinnabar, heated in the presence of oxygen, it becomes HgO, mercuric oxide. And then you again heat it, it becomes, and you get oxygen. Here you get SO2. So you just heat it and you get the metal. They are low reactive metals. Similarly, for copper also, you get in CuTS form, right? You heat this CuTS, you get copper oxide, and in this copper oxide, you again heat in the same with this, you get copper. So that's how it is, right? So you just have to heat it, heat, and you get the metal. And that's the thing with the low reactive metals. For the metals in the middle reactivity series, such as iron, zinc, lead, copper, etc., they are moderately reactive, correct? And these are generally present in the carbonates or sulfides. So either carbonates or sulfides. But it is difficult to take out metal from the carbonates or sulfide ores. So we'll convert this into oxides, correct? So what we'll do is, we will convert this into oxides. So if it is sulfide, we can convert into oxide by roasting. And how do this? You heat in the presence of oxygen. So you have this zinc sulfate, you have a lot of oxygen, because a lot of oxygen is required. You heat this guy, you get zinc oxide. And this process is called roasting, right? Roast a sulfide, sulfide to oxide. It's called roasting in the presence of oxygen. Then you have carbonate ores. Carbonate ores can also be converted into oxides by heating in the presence of limited air. And this process is called calcination, because if you see, there is no oxygen required here, right? So you have zinc carbonate, you heat it, it becomes zinc oxide and carbon dioxide, correct? So zinc carbonate is a carbonate thing, you convert this to oxide. Here also zinc sulfate, you made it to zinc oxide, because it is easy to get zinc from zinc oxide. So this process is involved if you have carbonate or sulfide, and generally for metal reactive we get carbonate or sulfide compounds also, right? So we got carbon or sulfide compounds converted to oxide using calcination or roasting. So sulfides to oxide is roasting, carbonate to oxide is calcination, right? One way to remember this is, sulfide is sulfur actually, S-U-L-P-H-U-R. So S and R are matching. So when you have sulfur, you use roasting. And carbonate and calcination both starts with C actually. So if it is carbonate, we'll use calcination. So that's easy to remember. But for sulfide, it is roasting. Why? Because sulfur is R ends with, sulfur ends with R. So sulfur is roasting and carbonate is calcination, because both are C. Now once I have the oxide form, it can be reduced the corresponding metals by using reducing agent. And reducing agent, one of the examples is carbon, right? Because when zinc oxide is heated with carbon, it gives zinc. You have zinc oxide, when you heat with carbon, you get zinc. And carbon is very cheap, right? So you heat zinc oxide or any metal oxide with a reducing agent like carbon, you get carbon monoxide and zinc. But we can't use carbon everywhere. For some reactive metals, we can't use carbon. So in that case, we use displacement reaction. If you see, sometimes displacement reaction is used, and for example, sodium, calcium, aluminium, etc. are used as reducing agent in this case. Sometimes when you can't use carbon, in that case, we use sodium, calcium and copper. For example, manganese, you have manganese oxide, you can't use carbon. So in that case, we'll use aluminium. So you get manganese out and Al2O3, and you get heat also, correct? Sometimes we can't use these directly. And please note that these displacement reactions are highly exothermic. The amount of heat evolved is so high that the metal produces the molten state.
very, very, very exothermic. It is very, very high.
Now we'll discuss a new type of reaction called Thermit reaction. So reaction of iron oxide with aluminium to join railway tracks generally is used called Thermit reaction. They are used to join metals. They are used to join metal, metal parts. And the reaction is that this, you have iron oxide, you have aluminium, you get iron and Al2O3 and heat. It generates heat actually. And this melts the metal actually, and the metal is joined. This reaction is called Thermit reaction, a very common reaction to join the metal parts. Reaction name is Thermit reaction. So in this case, if you see, these metals are very reactive. On the top of the activity series, they are very, very reactive, right? And they cannot be obtained by heating with carbon. Why? Because if you see, they carbon will not be able to reduce the oxides of sodium, magnesium, calcium. Carbon will not be able to, right? Why? Because these metals have more affinity towards oxygen than carbon. So that's why we can't use carbon. We can't use this carbon. We can't use this carbon for these metals, right? That's why we use electrolytic reduction. Electrolytic reduction. In this case, for example, sodium, magnesium and calcium can be obtained by electrolytic reduction of their molten chlorides. For example, you have this sodium chloride molten form. And then in this case, you use electrolytic reduction. The metals will be deposited at cathode and chlorine will be deposited at anode. I'll show you how. Example, if you see at cathode, you have this guy, right? So you have this cathode here, let's suppose, which is negative charge. And you have anode here, which gives a positive charge. That means there are very lot of electrons, free electrons here, right? Because cathode will give negative charge, so a lot of free electrons will come here. So this guy is NaCl solution. Let's suppose NaCl solution, sodium chloride. So NaCl will be in this form, Na plus Cl minus, Na plus Cl minus, like this. So since it is Na plus, it will be attracted towards this electrons, correct? Because there are so many electrons, this is a negative charge, this is positive, it will be attracted, negative and positive attracts, right? This guy attracted, and chlorine will be attracted towards this side, this positive charge, correct? Sorry, this guy positive. So if you see what happens is, end of the day, I have my this cathode and I have my this anode. So all my chlorine ions will come here and all my sodium will. So now what happens is, the sodium plus from NaCl will get an electron from this guy, it will become sodium and will get deposited here, right? And at anode, this guy chlorine minus will get this, will lose one electron to this guy, because you see the electron flows like this, right? Electrons flow like this. So lose one electron and will become chlorine gas and it will get deposited here. You understand the logic, what is happening here? So we have this container and we have this, some solution here, which is the nothing but sodium chloride, molten sodium chloride, and molten sodium chloride is NaCl molten, which has Na plus and Cl minus. So Na plus will get attracted toward this electron that is a negative side, and Cl minus will get attracted toward the positive side, and this, all this chlorine gas will get in this part, that is the anode part, and all this sodium will get in this part, that is cathode part, and that's how this extraction happens, correct? So once I have my metal extracted using the various process described, I have to refine these metals, right? Thank you. Visit examfear.com to watch free educational videos, try free online tests, get the best quality study materials, study from the best tutors and mentors, and much more. Thanks once again.